The test complete. Smith and his legal team now wait for the results.
Dr. Robert Huizenga joins me now. That was your footage, your technology. What was it like when you joined Gary going into that device?
I was very scared, I have to admit. I've done a lot of interviews, and I'm thinking to myself, here's a trained killer, an Army Ranger, who was convicted of murder, and I've agreed to interview him a couple days later to give him the results. He claims he's innocent. Of course, lots of convicts might say that in jail. And like, what was it going to be like to look a guy in the eye and say, you're a cold-blooded murderer, you did it, you've been lying all along? And I was panicked.
So Dr. Huizenga and his brother have a business that's trying to market fMRIs for use in the criminal justice system. You've become very passionate about this area. Why is it so important?
I believe this could change the way that we see each other. I mean, we can call people's bluff, and it's the first unbiased, scientifically backed way to differentiate a lie from truth-telling. And there's 102 articles about it, over 500 authors, multiple machines, multiple countries. It's very robust scientifically. I know you're a scientist at heart. This is not some fly-by gimmick.
So polygraphs, the lie detector test that everyone knows about, they're the sort of the standard for detection, but they're not allowed in court either, right?
They're not allowed in court because they're totally inaccurate. Even the CIA says they only work 60% of the time.
So why do you think this technology offers a solution where they fail?
Everything else hasn't been studied. Ballistics, blood spatter that you heard mentioned there, toxicology, even fingerprinting. They're grandfathered forensic techniques, never been scientifically validated. Now we have, short of DNA, the first scientifically validated forensic study. And I think it's going to be crucial if we're interested in a better judicial system going forward.
All right, so let's talk about functional MRIs for 1 second, just to get you on the same page. So they're used right now for checking memory, diagnosing Alzheimer's. Chronic pain is something that we can tell if you truly have it or not based on fMRIs. It's a great tool to image the brain, but it's a big step to go beyond that because it's largely experimental when used for things like, for example, telling if someone's telling you a lie or not.
Well, it's been out for 15 years, so yes, it's experimental. Yes, more studies always have to be done, but even at this stage, it's a far more reliable technique than a lot of the stuff we're using.
Right, let's show everybody what we're talking
sure.
about. Dr. Huizenga believes it can help you detect a lie, so I want you to take an opportunity to explain to everybody how this might work. So let's start off with a polygraph.
Get Absolutely.
Folks to appreciate what this
Here
does.
Here you can see they're just basically testing peripheral nervous function. What's your heart rate? What's your breathing rate? How much are you sweating? These are peripheral nervous functions, but as you know, some innocent people are very anxious, they fail. Some guilty people, calm as a cucumber, they pass. Right. Not a great test. Now, when you look at the functional MRI, you're going inside the brain. This is a paradigm shift in how we analyze truth-telling. And they go inside this machine, and they can't move a muscle. If you move it, invalidates the test. And you just yes, no to very critical questions. And we ask 20 questions. Five of them are simple truths, you know. What car do you drive? Things that we can validate. Then, in this case, we would say to Mike McQueen, to Gary Smith, did you share an apartment with Mike McQueen? That's an emotional truth. And he says, yes. Then we tell him, lie on everything related to your military experience. And then we see what his brain does there. Then we ask the questions we're interested in, you know? And we're looking what goes on in the brain when he tells the truth, what goes on in the brain when he lies. And I'd like to do an example with you.
Sure.
I'm gonna ask you to honestly tell me, are you a physician practicing in New York City?
I am.
Okay, this is what the MRI would look like if you answered that inside that machine. And you can see a series of areas light up. The color is a function of the delta, the change in blood flow to those areas. Which areas are working harder? And the shocking thing is not that we see a picture of your brain, but that everyone of different ethnicities, ages, and even languages has the same pattern for truth-telling. That's a shock. No one ever expected that.
Right.
So now I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to intentionally lie. When you were a medical school, when you were a medical student, were you class president?
I was not.
That's a lie. I know that. Yeah. And so if we asked you that question under the machine, a totally different but yet reproducible area of the brain lights up. Because when you tell the truth, that's relatively simple. But when you have to massage the truth and you have to come up with a lie, that requires a lot more brain power and different areas of the brain light up. But again, the shock is that different people, even people with psychiatric disease, that the same areas light up when you're telling a lie. And that's the basis of this whole new technology.
All right, so just to go over this one more time, because we're going to cover this again, there's not one truth section of the brain, right? There's not a truth area and a lie area. You're looking at how the brain copes with trying to tell
multiple
the truth or lie. So now that we know that, up next, did the results of Gary's brain scan bring anyone closer to finding out what really happened to Michael McQueen? Plus, the big question, the big one out there, would you trust a test like this enough to determine whether an accused killer should walk free? Think about that. We'll be right back.
When we come back, inside the brain of convicted killer Gary Smith. But will it prove his innocence in a second trial?
I want you to read and tell me whether you think this matches up best with the truth or whether Gary has in fact been lying all along.
How's it going, Doctor?
Good, good. Nice to finally meet you.
You too.
What we did with your brother is we asked him 20 questions. And they all randomly popped up every 4 or 5 seconds, so he didn't get a chance to even think about them. So based on these questions, we got a very good, very clear idea about what Gary's brain does when he lies and what Gary's brain does when he's telling the truth. So then we asked him 5 questions that had to do with this criminal case. We didn't know what the answer was. You've been one of Gary's biggest supporters, so I want you to read and tell me whether you think this matches up best with the truth or whether Gary has in fact been lying all along.
It's definitely the truth.
It's definitely the truth.
Yeah.
You were telling the truth.
I'm back with Dr. Robert Huizenga, who we just saw give Gary Smith his fMRI results. I'm also joined by David Moisey, Gary's defense attorney. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
So, were these fMRI results we just saw delivered to Gary admissible at that second trial?
No, unfortunately, the judge on the second trial excluded the results, and we expected that going in.
I was so angry sitting in that court and seeing the injustice. Number one, we have a method. Why does a judge get to take the power out of the hands of the people? Let's let the jurors decide if this is accurate or inaccurate, like they do for every other forensic test. Why can a judge just out of hand throw out one of the most accurate techniques we have out there?
Looking at the brain. You know, I could say in the, you know, that those jurors that you spoke to would have changed their mind. The question is it the right thing to do? So Dr. Huizenga, you spent a lot of time researching this. I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Well, it's really interesting because the simple countermeasures, like moving your hands and feet, obviously you can see. And what he's describing, these are tests where they didn't look at the motor strip. So the minute you look at the whole brain, you can't hide. So we can see when you're doing those countermeasures. So the countermeasure thing, interesting, was 100% when you didn't do countermeasures, and you can see when they're doing countermeasures. So that's really not an issue. The thing about real life emotion, it's really interesting. When we ask somebody like Gary Smith, unemotional truth, really emotional truth, there's no difference in that pattern. And so this is something that's brought up by people that are used to the old polygraph, where unemotional and emotional makes a huge difference in your peripheral system. But curiously enough, it doesn't appear to in the central system. And lastly, people with different thought processes and consolidating truth in different ways, we've done this study on schizophrenics, and shockingly to me, it still works. So I think that I respectfully disagree, and I think that this is something that is close to getting the right studies to make it a legit, totally life changer in this country and in our judicial system.
Is this fMRI generally accepted among world-class neurologists?
There's nothing generally accepted in anything, and the problem is all the other forensic techniques have been grandfathered in and we know are poor. This one has its problems, and you can elaborate further on them, but what we're using now, blood spatter, ballistics, even fingerprinting, has never been rigorously tested, and at least this has 102 studies, all of which are positive.
Dr. Marshall?
I would just say that, you know, ultimately this is a testable question, and we're learning more and more about the brain. It's fascinating stuff.